What motivated me to write the book, I mean, I've been in the courts for 30 years. We've been fighting for people who are on death row, fighting for people wrongly convicted and unfairly sentenced. And I was initially persuaded that we could get courts to respond and we could achieve justice. I'm a product of Brown versus Board of Education. I grew up in a community where black kids couldn't go to public schools, and it was the court that opened those doors. The political environment would never have tolerated an end to racial segregation. So I believed in that. And about 10 years ago, I realized that we probably couldn't win Brown versus Board of Education in the US today. I don't think our court today would do something that disruptive on behalf of poor or disenfranchised people. And that's because the larger environment has become so tolerant of inequality. We've accepted so much bigotry and injustice. So it was important to start talking in a broader space about these issues. And you're right, what's happened in America over the last half century is tragic. We had 300,000 people in jails and prisons in 1972, 2.2 million today, 6 million people on probation and parole. There are 70 million Americans with criminal arrests, which means that when they try to get jobs or loans, they're disfavored. Women going to prison increased 646% in the last 25 years. And there's this statistic, 1 in 3 black male babies born in America is expected to go to jail or prison, and nobody's talking about it. And so getting a story out there that got people to understand that these are not just data, these are not just stories, these are human tragedies, this is suffering, this is cruel, this is abusive, became a priority, and that's why it's been so exciting to be a part of a process where some of the most talented people in the world have given their all, and that's what's moved me most about the performances. Everybody up here didn't just know their lines, just didn't know their spaces. They gave their hearts to this project, and you see it in the film. And I think and I hope that people will have a better appreciation for why we should never tolerate inequality. We should never tolerate injustice. And that's what's exciting to me about this process, is that maybe we can break down some of the indifference that's allowed these problems to persist. I believe that we cannot change the world. We cannot increase justice if we stay in safe places that are distant. We're going to get it wrong. Our politicians make that mistake. They come up with solutions that aren't effective because they're so far away. They don't hear the things you need to hear when you're proximate to people who are suffering. They don't see the things you need to see when you're in proximity. And I just think orienting people to this concept of proximity is really important, and it's a human concept. You know, this was taught to me by my grandmother. I had one of those amazing African-American matriarchs who was the grandmother in my family, and she was tough and strong, but she was kind and loving. She was the end of every argument in our family. She was also the start of a lot of arguments in our family. When I was a little boy, I got about 9 or 10, and she started worrying about me, and she would come up to me, and she'd give me these hugs, and she would squeeze me so tightly, I thought she was trying to hurt me. And then she'd see me an hour later, and she'd say, Brian, do you still feel me hugging you? And if I said no, she would jump on me again. And I didn't appreciate it until I got much older. She lived into her 90s. She worked as a domestic her whole life. And then she fell one day and broke her hip. Then she was diagnosed with cancer, and she was dying. I was in college at the time, and I went to see her. And it was heartbreaking for me to have to say goodbye to her. And I was sitting there, and I was holding her hand. Her eyes were closed. I wasn't even sure she could hear what I was saying, but I was pouring my heart out. And I didn't want to leave, but I knew it was time to leave. And I got up to leave, and I was about to walk away. And that's when my grandmother opened her eyes, and she squeezed my hand. And then she looked at me, and the last thing she said to me, she said, Brian, do you still feel me hugging you? And then she said, I want you to know I'm always going to be hugging you. And I have felt the embrace of that woman my entire life. And for me, what we're trying to say is that if we get closer to the poor and the excluded and the incarcerated and the condemned and the forgotten and the disfavored, at a very minimum, we can wrap our arms around them and affirm their humanity and their dignity. And that's how you create more justice. That's how you change the world. And we hope this movie inspires people to reach out to the Minnies and the Ralph Myers and the Ray Hintons and the Walter McMillans and the Herbert Richardsons, because they're all around us. You know, we make statements at the end of this movie. And what we're basically asking people to do is to understand the reality that created this story. And I think part of the reason why we have tolerated so much bigotry and discrimination for so long is that we've accepted a narrative about the relative importance of that. And this film is about trying to change that narrative, trying to get people closer to the suffering. When Herbert Richardson is executed, you can't not care about the wrongfulness of that. And when you see Karen's performance as a spouse, as a mother, you can't not care about what it would feel like to have somebody you love snatched away from you. And I think that's the challenge, because most people don't get to see it through that lens. That's why I'm so proud of these performances. Jamie's performance as Walt McMillan makes it hard for people to deny the humanity of a condemned man on death row. You know, Rob's performance does the same thing. O'Shea's performance does the same thing. And that's the challenge. We're in the middle of a narrative struggle. You know, we are in the United States and in this country, we are still burdened by a history of racial inequality. It's created a kind of smog in the air. We breathe it in every day. And the narratives of racial difference that we've inherited, the Native genocide that nobody talked about, 2.5 centuries of slavery that we didn't pay attention to, we've got to change that narrative. You know, the great evil of American slavery wasn't involuntary servitude, it was this ideology of white supremacy, this idea that black people aren't as good as white people, that their lives don't matter. And that's why I've always argued that slavery didn't end in 1865, it just evolved. We had 100 years of lynching, segregation, all of that. And today we're still living at a time where there's a presumption of dangerousness and guilt that gets assigned to black and brown people. But to challenge that, we're going to have to change the narrative. And we haven't done the storytelling part of that. We have 100 Holocaust films and we need them all. They're beautiful, they're powerful, and we have a consciousness about the Holocaust that changes your relationship to that issue. You go to Germany, you see stones everywhere, you see memorials everywhere. The Germans are trying to change the narrative. They don't want to be thought of as Nazis and fascists. There are no Adolf Hitler statues in Germany. But in this country, we don't talk about slavery, we don't talk about lynching, we don't talk about segregation, we don't talk about race. And it takes storytelling like this to create a comfort zone, a space where we can have these conversations. And what's been amazing, when we've done a few things, the questions people want to ask are questions about how we change things. What do we do? How do we make a difference? And I think that's the power of this. And I'm thrilled that this industry has created a space, and talented directors like Destin and performers like the people here have been willing to take the risk of actually doing something real and authentic. It's not, for me at least, and I think for everybody here, just about entertainment. It's about, can we change the environment where justice can actually be achieved? And that's the exciting part for me. And it's for everybody, because many people of color have given up too. I work in those communities, which is easier to sometimes just not care than to struggle. And as a product of somebody who struggled, you know, the line that Michael has in the movie is a real line. We do have to stand up when other people say sit down. We do have to speak when other people say be quiet. Black, white, brown. And that's the theme of the movie that I hope people will see, and not only see, but be motivated to take action behind. We still are working with a system that is very resistant to fairness. We still have one of the highest death sentencing rates in the country, one of the highest execution rates. We're in a very hostile political environment. There are 19 appellate court judges in Alabama. None of them are black, even though the state is 28% black. There's still resistance, but we are fighting. And I think that's the real change, that there's a community of people. I now have 150 people on my staff. We've opened this museum called the Legacy Museum, from slavery to mass incarceration. We have this national memorial, and these landmarks have literally changed the landscape. So things have changed, but we're still in the early innings of a real struggle. We are still at the very beginning. And what I keep saying to people is that we're going to need a whole era of truth and justice. It's not going to happen on one day. It's not going to happen in 1 year. We need a whole era to respond to a half century of mass incarceration and 400 years of racial bigotry. But it won't happen if we don't fight. And what makes me excited is that we're fighting, and now we're fighting with tools that we never imagined were possible. Incredibly talented people, Warner Brothers, this industry contributing in a major way. And people will see this film who are reluctant, but hopefully will come out inspired to do more. So we're still in the middle. This is a very challenging political moment. Not only in the United States, but across the world. There's a lot of othering going on. There's a lot of hatred. There's a lot of fear and anger. And the politics of fear and anger will make you tolerate things you're not supposed to tolerate. But there's also a response, and I'm thrilled that this is part of that response.